Thank you. Questions, if anybody's got any.
What's your songwriting process? Do you use any programs to help you songwrite, or do you just go by like trying to like loop things, or do you like just transcribe it all like on a Tux guitar, like Guitar Pro or something?
Yeah, I think I always try to write guitar first. I think in the past it was a lot of riffs, riff one, riff two, and it kind of lost the full concept for me. So I think now when I work on songwriting, I try to have something like outside of music. Conceptually, have like a story because it's gonna make the music seem more, I guess, heavy to me. But yeah, I use Logic. I pretty much write everything, scratch tracks before showing it to the band, and then go into a rehearsal room with a bunch of guys and go, this is how I think I have it mapped out. And from there, we'll kind of change it section to section. I think transitions are the toughest thing with like progressive music.
I was about to ask, like, how do you like deal with transitions and like knowing how to continue a song and knowing when to stop?
Yeah, it's especially tough in a genre where you're kind of touching on so many different types of like atmospheres, and
because you can keep going and going.
Yeah, there's really no rules, and that's what's kind of always made me gravitate towards this kind of genre too, because I can pretty much go wherever I want with stuff. But a band like Between the Bear to me is like the perfect example of like how to transition right in progressive music. I mean, like, they're like New Age Rush to me. So if like you listen to those guys, how they go from like a different time signature, like they use like internal time signature modulation, so they'll take something in 4/4 and then they'll accent in a different way, and then they'll kind of modulate that into the same thing where the groove stays pretty similar. I mean, that's the toughest thing if you have two completely different riffs or atmospheres that are, it's such a drastic change. It's like, it's gonna be kind of hard for the listener to kind of like smooth into it. So you're almost like kind of whining and dining the listener almost when you're playing this music. You don't want to have anything that's such a chaotic jump. And time signature modulation is a good way to do that. But there's no rules, man. I could ask these guys the same thing, like how they approach writing music, and I think we all do it so differently. That's the beauty of it too.
Yeah.
So hopefully that answers.
Yeah, that was good.
Anybody else?
Wes, I had a question from one of the attendees of which pickups you're using of ours.
Lithiums. Right. Yeah, I got the lithiums and a bunch of different my guitars. These sound a little different because they have the covers on them, and I think they put wax to glue them in there. They sound a lot warmer than they used to, but the lithiums are super dynamic pickups. I mean, from like super tight, you know, rhythm sounds for distortion and like open leads, and I haven't really seen a need to switch for them because I think that they do everything for me. But yeah, my Holdsworth has the Holdsworth pickups in it. I'm pretty sure that guy knew what sounded good, so I didn't really question that ever. All these pickups have like different characteristics to them, but in the end of the day, I think it's all about what's coming out of your hands, because like anybody can pick up any guitar, whether it's got single coil, PAF, Seymour Duncan's, I mean, you name it, you're still gonna sound like yourself, because most of the tone is coming from the articulation of your fingers.
What's your practice schedule like? Regiment.
I really don't practice anymore. I think I like exhausted my technical. I hit like a technical ceiling on my own playing, and I've kind of realized that. I've never been a good alternate picker, sweep picker, like all the really like crazy shred guitar stuff. I've kind of like stayed away from, and like what gets me up in the morning is like songwriting. Kind of focus on that more. That's what like it's a more enjoyable experience for me if I'm like running through different compositions and stuff, and like that's more exciting for me now. But back in the day, I used to lock myself in my bedroom for hours and hit the metronome, but I think those days are like over, because it's like I don't want to throw my guitars against the wall and beat my head against the wall, because it's guitars tough, man. It kicks my ass every single day. I hook it up. But yeah, it's it's always something you can improve on too, and there's always going to be guys that are better or worse. I mean, it's like, it's such a wide spectrum. It's like realizing what you're really good at and kind of like blowing it out of water. So I know I'm really good at like these certain things, and if I can do that in every single composition that I have, that's going to make it more worthwhile for me to get up every day and play guitar. Cool. Any more before I play two more?
Who are your main influences?
Now, I think they've changed. In the beginning, when I first started listening, I think the first record I ever got was Green Day Dookie.
Yes.
Power Records. It's pretty crazy to think how the CD games changed over the years. Now everything's pretty much on a digital platform. But yeah, I remember getting Dookie, and I was like obsessed with like the palm muting technique. Really, like the sound his guitar was making. I was like, how the hell do you get that sound? I was like 8 years old. I had no idea.
That's awesome.
I started listening to bands like Blink 182, and it's kind of in that punk rock phase until my dad showed me Rush at like a pretty early age, and that was kind of like the catapult for me to like get into like progressive music, and discovering guys like Eddie Van Halen kind of opened up the possibilities of what like an electric guitar can do, and it really got me into like guys like Greg Howe. I think I had Greg Howe's Parallax in my CD changer for like 6 straight years.
CD changer.
The 6 CD changer, and I never took it out of the car. That was always on rotation. I probably listened to that record like 5,000 times, and I just became obsessed with like his touch and his playing. And I never transcribed any of his licks ever. I always thought it was like kind of like sacred. So if I listened to him so much, it kind of like blended into the way I like play with the kind of the hybrid, more fingerstyle stuff too. The way he approaches like lead guitar, but yeah, and then you discover guys like Alan Holdsworth, and it's like a whole new kind of like alien landscape, the way that guy crafted guitar and all the kind of different, the sounds he was getting out of his guitar, and yeah, it's pretty endless, but I think now it's segueing more into like non-guitar based music and more like full band compositions. I love the band Bentney, they're one of my favorites, more like the artsy type stuff, and like really getting to production, like kind of taking a step away from the guitar and not caring about like technical stuff so much and listening to like music for like music, you know.
Cool. What do you think you like something that's helped you, like what do you practice before, do you think that's helped you a lot now, like as in songwriting, intervals, stuff in the guitar?
Like ear training has been huge for me. But that's just like listening to like a wide array of music too. I get in my car and I put on K-Jazz 88.1 on Long Beach, and like I worship that radio station because they're always playing new stuff. It's not like one of those top 40 ones that just keeps recycling the same stuff. And, you know, hear all these, you know, Miles Davis, Coltrane, and like what those guys were doing back in the 50s and 60s was like so forward and so like so progressive in terms of jazz too. So that's what I kind of, you kind of start to listen to that in a different light after playing your own instrument, and you kind of, the way Coltrane plays like a saxophone, you're like, that's the way he's playing, that's the way he views music. It's like, how do I view music? And it's like listening to music, I think, all different types is the best way to get better. And constantly recording yourself too, like having a DAW. I've had Logic for years, and I'm always, even when I can't play guitar, like I've been in Justin's shoes where I can't physically play, and I'm just sitting there like orchestrating music and MIDI, and just constantly surrounded by just like composition. And I think recording yourself every day is the best way to get better, because you'll listen, and the metronome doesn't lie, the recording doesn't lie, and you'll start to pick up all these little intricacies of your playing that suck. And you'll focus on those things that suck, and then you'll just be like, how can I make it better for myself? And not focusing on, you know, appeasing anyone else in the process. Like, only appease yourself. I think that's the biggest thing that's helped me throughout the years, and not really giving a shit about what other people think or say, and just kind of taking chances in music. And there's so many different ways to express yourself outside of the guitar too, with different compositions, different instruments. You can hang around people that don't play your own instrument. That was huge for me when I went to school. Hang out with a lot of like piano players and saxophone players, because their harmonic language is so different than mine. You know,
yeah.
The way I view music is almost kind of two-dimensional at first. I'm just looking at a fretboard. That's it. But then you start to see all these other people kind of occupy space with improvisation and stuff, and it's like, it's pretty beautiful. I mean, so yeah, surround yourself with different types of music and different types of instrumentalists too, and I think that's the best way to get better, because you're gonna start sounding like a non-guitar player. And that's the goal, to not pick up the guitar and be like, I'm a guitar player, you know? It's like, I'm a musician. You know, that's the most important thing at the end of the day, and I think a lot of people get caught up in like technical stuff and trying to push like the envelope of like what's really good on the instrument. It's like, it's not really about any of that at the end of the day. It's about just creating like really interesting stuff, I think.
Yeah. Why'd you pick Kiesel?
Great question. when I went to a Musicians Institute back in 2013, I went to Santa Cruz College, got a business degree, and then I was like, man, I'm not gonna go into that white collar 9-to-5 world. So I, you know, went into Musicians Institute and really just kind of blew it out of the water with like studying music and stuff. And our school gave us a 40% discount at all these different guitar companies, and Sir was one of them, and I was pretty like locked on Sir for a while. And, but then I talked to the guys at the company, and it was like a eight month turnaround, and it was like $6,000, like all this crazy stuff. And I was like, wait, I thought we were getting 40% off, and because I went nuts with all the features, you know, Buckeye.
Yeah, we all do.
Yeah, I mean, I'm on the Kiesel Builder like every day, specking out new guitars, and realizing that I can't have every guitar on the planet. But I specced out a Sir, and then wasn't really happy with how long it would take for it. And then the old Carbon store was right next to Mesa Boogie and Guitar Center in Hollywood. So I walked in there one day, and Chris Hong was there. And we just hit it off, played all the different guitars, super helpful, and they felt really good, sounded really good, and the turnaround for a custom was 8 weeks. And I was like, it's kind of a no-brainer. Paying a third of the price and way quicker turnaround. I had a carb top, that was my first Kiesel ever. Spalted maple, still have it, I'll never get rid of it. It's got the Carbon logo still on it. And then I got a Holdsworth. And then, I've just been obsessed with the guitars as soon as I started playing them. And I played a lot of different guitars with guys that toured with, all the different types of headless guitars, and boutique guitar manufacturers all over the world, and like they don't feel right. This one feels right.
Yeah.
I don't know why, it just feels right for me. So it's like the older you get too, you don't want to really complicate things. You want to just have like a really streamlined setup. And I have like 18, 20 guitars I've got rid of over the years, and in the beginning they're all, you know, crazy Floyd Rose, collar tremolos, fucked up necks and all this like weird stuff going on, and you realize like you don't want something complicated at the end of the day. And something that's really simple and easy for you, it's all about playability. I think, but like, it's nice having a guitar that can pretty much do everything too, and this one does everything for me. Cool. Should I play a two more?
Yeah.
All right. I shortened most of these songs because they're like 10, 15 minutes each.
Thank you.
C-sharp standard, C, drop C, and I was like, standard, and their face was just kind of like, playing in standard, but it's always felt really tight for me. I used to play in C-sharp standard with like 11 gauge, and I guess the tension of the strings felt the same, but there's a tightness in standard, and you don't really have to worry about anything once it's, especially these guitars, once they're locked. But I'll mess around with like open tunings like FAC, GAE, that's probably my favorite tuning right now. Like an acoustic guitar, I'll just put that in it. Really cool open sound. Dadgad is another cool one. I don't even know why I'm talking about tunings right now. Standard.
What's how market yourself as a guitar player in your album and social media, and so you can be like in places like this where you can like be away from where you're from?
I'm probably not the best person in marketing, but. I never really focused on marketing, even though it's like the most important thing nowadays with social media and stuff. And it's almost like coming up when I was younger, like it wasn't about that at all. Playing in like a local band in high school, and like all we tried to do was rehearse and get really tight for a live show. Like that was the most important thing ever. It wasn't about how many likes we had on Facebook or MySpace back in the day.
Yes.
That's crazy to think about. But I think now with like the changing climate, like everyone has like an online identity too, and I've always tried to be like as honest as possible, and hopefully it like shows when I'm hanging out with people and going to shows and stuff and coming out to, this is my first clinic I've ever done, so this is like a whole new experience for me too, and I'm nervous as hell, but hopefully it translates. And constantly putting out like material too via like Instagram, constantly sitting in your room and cranking out lots of videos. It's, like, it's important nowadays because people like look for that stuff. People look at like your reach and your followers, and that's just kind of the state of the game. And what we all kind of have to play it a little bit. Even though I wish I didn't have to sometimes, I wish I could just sit in my room and just play guitar for hours like I used to do and just not care about anything else. And like that's why I love playing guitar. But like there's always that added pressure to like have something ready or showcase some kind of thing, but it's cool because it's constantly making you get better too. And I've met so many amazing people around the world that use like Instagram and Bandcamp and stuff, and guys I will talk to for years, and then I'll go tour with them, you know, and we'll meet up. And I think it's pretty amazing what you can do with technology now, and you can communicate with band members that are halfway across the world. I mean, we just played in Europe, and our old drummer lives out in Frankfurt, and he learned everything. We had notes throughout, you know, a session, and it was kind of cool. While we met up, we hadn't seen each other in 2 years, and we just started playing again. Like we had been right there next to each other. So I think that's what's great about technology now. It's like you should definitely take advantage of it, and it'd be kind of dumb not to. Because I mean, there's you can go on YouTube, and like that's like a massive like library for like lessons and gear, and like you can learn so much from the internet too. I think nowadays that's how most people learn their stuff. They'll just type in something on YouTube or Google, and like that's how they're getting most of their information too. But yeah, it's so important to like be out there playing shows in the real world and like talking to people and networking, because that's like that's the biggest thing really, is developing relationships with people outside of the internet. You know, so yeah. That's the most meaningful type of relationship, I think.
How do you approach your solos? Do you go for certain target notes? Do you go for certain arpeggios, or do you just go answer, you know, question? Do what is your likes?
The whole Hans Zimmer. Here's a question.
Yeah.
I think they're all different in a sense that I'm throwing on the backing track or whatever kind of section I'm trying to play the lead over and struggling for like a couple hours, like really struggling to find like what sounds the best. I'm not worried about like what scale I'm playing on. It's like I have to play Lydian over this chord. It's like that, none of that really matters. You can play something completely atonal, it'll still sound really cool like in the context of it. Like focus on your ears at the end of the day and kind of get away from theory and all that theoretical kind of stuff. So if you just focus on like using your ears, I think that's the biggest thing when you're composing, especially like solos too. But like it's nice when some leads have like a big array of like techniques, and they're very diverse too. They start really nasty, or they end kind of melodic. It's like it's nice kind of going through a lot of different types of like emotions within one solo. But there's also solos that are like really short, like 10 seconds long, that are just like really nasty and like as disgusting as it possibly is. Like that's what it really calls for right there. It would be weird if you played like a ZZ Top blues or something like that. Like the chord behind it is like that. It's like you're not gonna play like a straight up blues lick over that. You're gonna have to try to go out of your way to find some kind of, now it's arpeggio sequence or tapping sequence, but like it usually takes a while to like find a lot of that stuff, and it doesn't come to me very easily. I've never been the best improviser, and just throwing on the track and just constantly experimenting is the coolest thing too, because you'll play stuff that you never thought you would in the first place. Because you can look at a solo outside of your guitar theoretically, and then you think, oh, I'm gonna play this kind of certain vibe, but then you start playing it in your practice room, you're like, that actually sounds like shit. You know, so you have to experiment with all these different types of arrays of techniques. But yeah, there's Steven Toronto is like, I think, the best lead player out there right now. And he did a guest solo on our last record. I listened to the way he like composes his solos. Like even songs are like, it's a solo the entire song, essentially. Mm-hmm. But like the way he like breaks off for a lead, it's like, you know, it's like, here we go, we're going on a ride. And it's like, it's almost like preparing the listener for like, all right, let's hear some like really nasty stuff. And he kind of sets it up in a good way too. But you have to practice your technique, all that stuff. But like Hendrix never learned how to read music and didn't probably practice technique. He played with like five strings with Little Richard's band, but he made solos sound nasty. He made them work. So like having, the versatility to kind of do what you want in the moment, if that answers your question.
Yeah.
Long-winded. One more song?
Yeah.
I don't have any more questions.
Oh yeah, a couple of these songs, like so there's a lot of comping going on for like guest solos too. Like that last song, you didn't know, it's like towards the end of the song, it's really gnarly thread section. And it's one of my buddies from Japan. He plays with like Winds of Saturn and all these other bands, and he's like the guy for like alternate picking. And alternate picking's never been my like forte. Being the worst alternate picker in the world, but like when I heard that section, I was like, that's what I needed in that section. So it's kind of cool with technology too, to kind of bring full circle. There's such a wealth of like amazing players out there, and you can talk to them every day online through your phone. It's like it's pretty amazing, like the kind of dynamic world we live in. It's so different than what I used to be when I was a kid playing bands and stuff.
Thank you.
Scott's gonna come up and it's gonna be a huge departure from what this stuff is, which is cool.